Welcome. We'll start with the second chapter for political science, where we would talk about federalism. Now, in the last chapter of political science, we have talked about four different types of power sharing. The one was the horizontal distribution of power. The second was the idea of federal structure of the government. The third was the community government. And the fourth was the coalition government. So we will focus on federalism for now. As we talked about in the last class, federalism talks about division of power between center and the state. So let's say we have numerous issues that we need to discuss about. It can be defense, it can be agriculture, it can be education, so on and so forth. So what we do is, we decide, okay, let's say defense would be looked after by the center, agriculture would be looked after by the state, and so on. So what happens is, the ruling becomes much more easy, the execution process becomes much more efficient. So that's the sole idea under the structure of federalism. We saw in Belgium how the unitary form of the government slowly and gradually after amendments between 1970 to 1993 shifted to a kind of federal structure where equal representations were given to both the states or both the linguistic groups. Similarly, under federal structure, what we do is, let's say central government would have so and so powers, state government would have so and so powers. We usually say that state government would look after the day-to-day functioning, the day-to-day administration at the local level, at the state level. However, center has much fewer subjects of more importance. However, the idea of federalism differs from state to state and country to country. So later on in this section, we would be focusing specifically on India. Let's first talk about the idea of federalism and the benefits. So if you look onto the world map here, out of the 192 states, you have 25 nations that have federal structure of the government. And these contribute to 40% of the population worldwide. So that's definitely a huge amount. And mostly, as you can see, bigger nations who are bigger in size, bigger in dimensions, usually have a federal structure so that the ruling becomes, or the execution of power becomes, much more efficient and better. Now, what are the basic features of federalism? First of all, as we said, there would be a division of power between the center and the state. Now, taxes would be collected, or revenue, we should say, would be collected separately at the state level and the center level, or if it's collected at one level, it would be divided for the center and the state in certain ratio or certain amount. Each body, the center and the state, would have their own jurisdictions. So let's talk about India. So let's say in India, at the national level, you would have Supreme Court. At the state level, you would have High Court. So that's the kind of jurisdiction that would be seen at each and every level. If there is requirement for the fundamental change in the constitutional provisions, both the center and the state should have their say and should have their yes, basically, to make that change in the constitution ultimately. It brings in more unity, tries to protect the regional diversity of each and every region, and maintains a mutual trust and agreement. Now, there are two basic forms of federalism that exist. This is a very, very important question. You have the coming together federalism and holding together federalism. In coming together federalism, we say you have independent states that are there, and they try to maintain their own identity and sovereignty and increase their security by coming together. That could be seen in the nations of Australia, Switzerland, and America. So all the states have equal power. They are as strong as the federal government. But in India, this is not the case. In India, we have a holding together federalism. Holding together federalism implies that the country is divided into states, but the center would divide the powers between the state and the center. So that's a basic difference between the coming together federalism and a holding together federalism. So let's talk about, for example, America. You have coming together federalism. So each of the state, be it the state of California, be it the state of New York or Oregon, each would have their own government and own constitution. However, when we talk about holding together federalism as in India, you have the center, which is much stronger than the respective state governments, and it would basically try to divide powers or say that, okay, state should need to look after these and these issues. So those two types of federal governments or federation are really very important to understand. Now let's come on to India. That's the major section that we would be talking about, or the major study that we would be doing. Now in India, we have division of powers at three level. All the powers that reside with the center are known as the union list, or the central powers, or the powers with the central government. The next is the powers that you have with the state that fall under the state list. And some of the powers are equally divided between the center and the state, and those goes to the concurrent list. So that's the division of power. Now coming on to the division of the government. At the center, you have the central government. Then you have the state, which has the state government, and then you have the local government. So local government can be RLG or ULG, that's the rural local government or the urban local government, which came up under the 73rd and 74th Amendment Act of the Constitution. Now at the center, as we say, we have the Prime Minister, we have the President of the country, and we have the Parliament. In the state level, we have the Chief Minister, we have the Legislative Assembly and the Vidhan Sabha and the Vidhan Parishad in certain cases. So you have that occurs at the state level, and then at the local level, you have the village panchayat, you have the panchayat samiti that we will discuss later. Now, when there was the division of powers between center, state and concurrent list, what happened was, after this was done, there were certain subjects that came up. Now, since these were already declared that this power or this ministry or this department would go to center, this would go to state and so on and so forth, what would happen to the things that came after the constitution was written? For example, computer softwares. Now, computer softwares was neither the part of central government nor the part of state government, because it was not a concept till the constitution came up. So finally, what happened was, it was put into the residuary powers. Now, residuary powers are those powers that are seen up or that are governed only by the center. So all the residuary powers are looked after by the union government, and computer software, since it came after the constitution was written, you have it lying in the residuary subjects. Now, you have the list of union list, the state list and the concurrent list, as we discussed, and some of the departments that are part of union list, state list and concurrent list. The next important topic is, in India, we say we have a federal structure which is holding together. The only state that has a separate constitution in India is Jammu Kashmir. So Jammu Kashmir has certain provisions. For example, a person who is not domiciled of that region cannot buy or sell land in that region. The next is the union territories. We say we have 29 states and 7 union territories. So those 7 union territories fall directly under the central government. They are not looked after by the state, or they do not have the powers as the states have. For any change that need to occur in any of these arrangements, what happen is, both the houses must have 2/3 of the majority. So when we talk about both houses, it's Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, and then it should be ratified by the legislatures of the states with at least 50% of the people who are accepting that ratification. When it comes to judiciary, we talk about resolution of disputes, solving of problems. So under resolution of disputes, we say at the center level, we have the Supreme Court. However, at the state level, you have the high courts that come up. Now, how do we practice federalism? Federalism is commonly seen in the democratic politics of a state or of a nation. In India, we initially started the division based on the language groups. So we had Andhra speaking people who demanded for a separate state. Then came up Marathis, Tamils, so on and so forth. So the initial division of India, after the independence, we had the division that came up on the linguistic basis. Despite that, we have certain states that are classified on the basis of culture, ethnicity, or the geographical conditions of that region. For example, Nagaland, you have Jharkhand, Uttarakhand, and so on. The last state that got separated was Telangana, that became a separate state in 2014 in India. So India basically follows a language policy. So when we say language policy, we say Hindi is the official language, but for all judicial purposes, English would remain the official language or the basic language. There are 21 other languages that have been recognized in the scheduled languages of India. Now, if we look around, we have nearly 1500 distinct languages, 114 major languages, but in the category of scheduled languages that are listed on the currency notes, that are listed in the constitution, we have these 22 languages that were part of the 8th schedule. Now, Hindi is the most popular of that. 40% of the population have the first language as Hindi. If we include the people who have their second language and the third language as Hindi, it comes to nearly 50%. But when it comes to English, it's only 0.02% who have English as their first language. But English coming up or becoming the second and the third language, you have 11% of the population. So most of the things that were non-Hindi states were starting to believe that Hindi should not be the official language of a country, because if that happens, we need to have our separate existence or a separate state. So government favored these conditions, and finally there was a ruling that said that all official documents and all judicial documents would remain in English. So therefore, center-state relations become very, very important. As we saw, after 1990s, we witnessed coalition governments in India. So regional parties try to come together and form a government at the center level. Till then, you had a single party that was winning the elections and was coming into power. Now, decentralization in India. So decentralization started with the Ashok Mehta committee, where we talked about decentralization at the rural level and the urban level. So primarily it was for the rural bodies. Under the rural areas or the rural local bodies, we have 1/3 of the seats that have been reserved for the female candidates. So power is being taken from the state to the local people. So once you have the local people who are coming into power, they have more representation, more decentralization, and more power that could be attained by them. So mandatory, it became mandatory later on to hold regular elections for local bodies, to have reservation for STSC and women at local level. And you have the Panchayati Raj system that evolved. Now, Panchayati Raj system, what it is, it's very interesting to understand. First of all, in the Panchayati Raj system, you have the lowest level, which is the village. So at the village, you have the Gram Panchayat that is seen. Now, this Gram Panchayat would have Panchayat. So Panch means five. So you would have Sarpanch and the other members of the ward, which are known as Panch, which would be the part of this Gram Panchayat. They are elected directly by the people and they take the decisions directly for the people. They approve the budget and review the performance. Above the village level, you have the Panchayat Samiti, or which is also known as the block or the mandal. It is the group of various villages coming together. So you have various villages that came together and this formed a block or a mandal or samiti. Now this samiti, the members are elected by the panchayat members of each village. So five members from this, five from this, five from this, together will elect the members at the district level. They form the Zilla Parishad. Now this Zilla Parishad have their own elected members. Sometimes they can be MLAs or MPs. And then you have the Jilla Person Chairman, that's the political head of the Jilla Parishad. Similarly, to the local area, the rural areas, you have the urban areas where you have municipalities. If it is a bigger urban area, you would have municipal corporations that would be seen. In the municipalities, you have the chairman, which is the head. In the municipal corporations, you have mayor, which is the head of the municipal corporations. Now, what is the institution of Jilla Parishad? As we discussed, Jilla Parishad is the political head Now, when we say the division of power, you have the district magistrate and the Jilla Parishad. What's the difference between the role of the two? District magistrate is chaired by a non-political head. So he is basically a civil servant or an administrative head. The decision making is done by the Zilla Parishad. The execution is done by the district magistrate. Now, the chairman of Zilla Parishad comes under the collector or the district magistrate, but above the additional collector, a good example of division of power is seen in the city of Port Aglares in Brazil. So what happened was, you had the decentralization with participative government or participative democracy that was seen in Brazil. What happened was, the different wards, the city was divided into wards or sectors, and each sector had its own meeting. So buses now run into poor colonies, and builders cannot basically have slum dwellers without resettling them. So all those developments came in the city because of the act of division of power and the involvement of local people into the budget and allocation of resources, so that even the common man and the poor gets the maximum benefit out of it. Coming on to the questions from this chapter, the first important question is, what is the difference between coming together federation and holding together federation? Why India is a holding together federation? That becomes the second most important question. The third important question is, what is the characteristic feature of a federal government? The difference between a federal government and a unitary government, explain with examples. Then a very important short question, or a kind of objective question, is, what are residuary powers? Who looks after the residuary powers in India? And again, a small question can be, what is concurrent list? So those are the important questions that could be taken out from this chapter. We would be covering the further chapters of political science. We'll complete political science first for class 10th, and then we'll move on to the history for the remaining chapters of history class 10. So stay tuned to our channel. If you have any doubts, you are free to jot them down as comments below the video. Have a very good day ahead.